Morning. Morning. I'm Trevor Dancer. I'm lead pastor here at First Shine Methodist Church. I want to welcome all of you here and to know above all else that it is our hope and desire that you connect with the living presence of Christ within our midst. Today we get to continue our series that we're calling To Be Continued. It's where we get to look at Jesus' last week of ministry and what we might learn from that, and then how we as modern day people are living in the To Be Continued. That the gospel story isn't over. The Jesus movement isn't over. It's not as though we read the gospel stories in the book of Acts and in the New Testament letters and call it done as a piece of history, but rather that we're actually living into what has come next now. And how might we do that individually and collectively? And today's story is an interesting one because it's Jesus knows that his ministry on earth is soon to be over. He knows that he's about to be betrayed and handed over to the Romans to be crucified and executed. And so he has this small window in which he can pass on any wisdom that he would like. Right? I mean, if you've ever sat by the bedside of a loved one that's dying and you get the chance to share all that you want with them, what would you say? Right? Or if you knew that tomorrow I'm going to be in a car wreck and I won't be able to see my kids again, what is the one thing you would say to them? Right? I mean, you would save it probably for like the most important, powerful, potent thing you can imagine. That if you could boil your life down and any teachings into one thing, this would be it. That's what Jesus is about to do. He gets his opportunity when two groups of Jewish leaders are coming to question him and trying to trap him and test him. In the two groups, you can almost imagine them like working in tandem, working together. One group is the Pharisees, these Jewish leaders that are very concerned with people following the Mosaic law and believing that in order to be the people of God, you have to follow every single law to the letter and hold people accountable to it. Not necessarily out of guilt or shame, but because they genuinely, authentically believe that was the only way to live into who God has called you to be. And there were some 613 laws, and these Pharisees knew many of them like the back of their hand and tried to uphold them to the best of their ability. And so they present Jesus this question that would surely entrap him. And they ask, essentially, Jesus, should we pay our taxes? That seems like a relevant question this time of year. And so what they're asking, though, is more than just should we pay our taxes. In the Roman Empire, the emperor was considered to be a god. In fact, when Emperor Augustus, he actually changed his name to Augustus, which means revered, elevating himself to godlike status. And later on, when Roman coinage was printed, it was printed with Caesar's face on it. And then later, he was actually added to the list of Roman gods that the Romans had to appease in order to have peace among the empire. And so in a sense, paying taxes was nothing less than giving an offering and giving yourself to emperor worship. So the Pharisees are asking Jesus, how do we reconcile this? How do we pay our taxes without adding worship to the emperor that we believe to be a false god? It's quite a conundrum. And so Jesus says, well, bring me a coin. And they show him the coin and he emphasizes Caesar's face on it. And then he gives this line that says, give unto Caesar what is Caesar's and give to God what is God's. In other words, give finite things to finite institutions. Give money to the empire, whatever. Pay those things, be good citizens, but give everything else to God. Give your heart, your will, your ambitions, your life. Hand those things over to God. So the Pharisees walk away, and you can sort of imagine them going up to the Sadducees and say, you're next. And the Sadducees are another group of Jewish leaders who were kind of particular in their worldview, but one of the things, defining characteristics is they did not believe in the general resurrection. They didn't necessarily believe in an afterlife and that everybody was going to be raised from the dead. And one of the ways to remember that is that because there was no resurrection, they were sad, you see. I promise, it is the worst joke I will ever tell. My wife is disagreeing somewhere. And so they go up and ask a question, and they try and give this parable to see what he would do. And according to Jewish law, that if a spouse dies, a woman's spouse dies, then she is to marry her husband's brother if she doesn't have a son. And in that way, then, it continues giving the possibility that she might have a son, which is in this day and age a high mark for women. And so they tell the story about this woman that her husband died, and then she married her husband's brother, and then he died, and then he married her husband's brother, and then he died, and goes through the line, about seven of them. And as you read it, you go, someone might want to investigate this woman. But that's not the point of the question. Jesus then be asked the question of, so whose spouse is she going to be in heaven? Trying to say, can you reconcile our laws of this side of the earth to heaven if you believe in such a thing? And instead of trying to get toiled up in the impossible question, Jesus dances around, and you can take this with a grain of salt as you will, but Jesus says in heaven there is no marriage, and instead when we all get resurrected, we're like angels. He says, I'm the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, these living ancestors, these living things, and says, I'm the God of the living, not the God of the dead. Focus on the living and the power of God rather than trying to reconcile things. So the Sadducees were sad that he didn't play his turn, or play their game rather, and so they go back to the Pharisees and you're up. And this time a Pharisee, a lawyer, they go out of their way to say in the text, a lawyer comes to them and he asks them an important question. He says, what is the most important law ever? And again, it's a trap, right? Because there's 613 of them, and in Pharisaic belief that if you disobey one law, then you have broken them all. And so you must follow them all, and therefore all of them are of equal importance. Let's see what Jesus says. So Jesus quotes two verses. One from Deuteronomy 6:5, the famous Shema, this prayer that is still today is said by many Jewish people in the morning and the evening. It's a devotion, it's a commitment to God. It says, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. That's the most important. But then he adds a bonus law, the next one. He adds a second, Leviticus 19:18. Says, you shall not take vengeance or bear a grudge against any of your people, but you shall love your neighbor as yourself, for I am the Lord. Pastor Karen shared this quote with us some time ago, but from Robert Mulholland, that says, the best translation is, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. Another way to say the same thing is you love your neighbor as yourself. That they are two sides of the same coin. They're not saying that you have to love God, and once you're able to do that, then you can love your neighbor, and those are the two most important things. It's actually, there is one most important thing ever. There's one law that is more important than any other law, and it's to love God, and to love neighbor. When asked this question, Jesus didn't stop and say that the most important thing is you have to show direct devotion to me and against all other gods. It doesn't say you have to stand against a certain list of things that you are against. Doesn't say the most important thing is that you have to follow certain traditions or ritual purity laws or social revolutions. He could have said a number of things that are most important to him, knowing that he has one final piece of teaching to give. That is to love. In fact, when you get to the Last Supper, the very last meal that Jesus has with his disciples before they disperse, he takes off his towel and he washes their feet, being a servant of love to them. Now, many of you are familiar with this, but there are four words for Greek, or for love in Greek. And the first is eros, this intimate, physical, passionate love. It's where we get the word erotic from. It's intimate, it's sexual. The next is phileo, not phileo fish. It means friendly love. It's the way you've developed relationships and bonds that stick with you for a lifetime, and you love them as though you're family. And the next is storge. And storge is family love. It's the way a parent looks into the eyes of their child for the first time and peers deep into the soul and says, you are mine. And suddenly your life vanishes before your eyes and theirs becomes more important than you ever dreamed yours could be. It's deep, storge. But the most important is agape love. Agape is unconditional love. This is the highest ideal of love. The kind of love that changes the way you view yourself and for others. This is love that picks you up and reminds you that you don't have to be enough to be enough. Reminds you that you don't have to do enough to be loved, that you are loved already just the way you are at this very moment, despite anything else that ever may occur. That this love is given to us freely from God. If you go to the book of John, written about 100 years or so after the Gospel of Mark and Matthew, during Jesus' last week, the word love is mentioned some 48 times. It's as though the tail end of the Gospel of John is screaming at us, this is the most important thing you could ever do, that if you get nothing else right in your whole life, love God and love neighbor. In fact, in John 13, he says this, he says, a new commandment I give you, that you love one another even as I have loved you, that you also love one another. And by this, people will know that you are my disciples, if you have love for one another. That's the trademark of discipleship, is do you love one another? Not did you win a certain amount of theological arguments to say that you were right, not did you stand up against a certain number of things of which you are against, not to say that you stood up for any number of things, but it is, did you love? Did you help people to know that they are included, that they are welcomed, that they are cherished? Matt Fulmer is pastor of United Methodist Church in St. Louis. I'm going to steal much of his language here. But he said, you've probably heard that God loves you as a kind of a basic message of faith for much of your life if you grew up in the church. It's as though that's almost kind of the starting point to where now we're sort of just numb to it. Like, it doesn't really mean anything to us. Right? We've heard it our whole lives, but maybe we haven't really embraced it. Maybe we haven't really explored what that really means to us. So another way of changing it, sort of throwing it off kilter to help us dive into what that might really mean is God likes you. God generally likes you. God delights in you. God rejoices over you. Think of it this way, that if God had a cell phone and had all your pictures on it, he would spend all of his time showing off the pictures of you to his friends. Right? God delights in you. God loves you. God is willing to invest in you. Have you ever seen the show America Ninja Warrior? It's kind of in the vein of American Gladiator, like super buff people enter themselves purposefully into an obstacle course of made up of all sorts of contraptions that ultimately lead to your doom, right? And then you run through it, and you'll never find these obstacles naturally in life ever, and yet they compete on this, and they're amazing athletes. And what I love about it is not only when they fall and splash, and that's fun, but when they're done, whether they succeed or fail, it's all the same. Their family that is over on the side cheering for them, and they're usually in matching T-shirts, and they're yelling their names, and they're getting sore, and no matter what happens by the end of it, there's this great big hug and embrace, and they just celebrate with them. They are delighted in these athletes, and they are proud, and they feel like they are successful even before the show begins. That's sort of how I imagine God to be with you. Not that God is sort of just overhead like, yeah, I love you, I'll tolerate you, move on, don't do your thing. It's God is sitting by you, rooting for you, actively cheering for you, hopeful for you, that whenever you come across difficult times in life and you find a pathway forward, God celebrates with you. When you go through a hard time where you're sick or something tragic has happened to you, God is sitting there grieving with you, supporting you, hugging you, helping you get through the next thing. God is proud of you. God's excited whenever you overcome difficult parts. God relishes in your company. Just yesterday, me and a few hundred of our best friends went to parks, because that happens when the sun comes out. And we went to this park playground where there was this 3- and 5-year-old playground thing. It's over at McKay Park, if you know what I'm talking about. And then next to it is the bigger kids' playground. And my 2-year-old, almost 3-year-old, thinks that he's in the big kid area already. And so he goes all the way up to the top, right? And I'm counting the number of ways in which he could fall and die to his doom. And there's these 2 tube slides that kind of are curly and whatever, and they look like really fun and made me jealous that I'm no longer 6 and want to go ride on them. And he goes up there all by himself. And you could tell he was a little uneasy about it. And I said, well, the quickest way down and safest is to go down the slide. And he gets on there and he props his little butt on the edge of this tube and he gets ready to go. And you could sort of see a shadow from the bottom of the slide. And he tumbles down the slide safely, right? And he gets to the end of it and he's kind of a little like, ah, what just happened? And then he wanted to do it again. I was so proud of him, so excited for him. And I think my kids know this, that they know that I love them. But it's a different ball game when they know that I am delighted in them, when I like them, when I'm relishing being with them. Sometimes whenever we hear the phrase, God loves you, we chop that up to that God tolerates us. That God loves us because God has to, and not much more. And in reality, God delights in you. God peers into your eyes and into your soul and says you are enough. I relish being with you. I relish watching you grow and thrive and become exactly who I've called you to be. Truth be told, we will spend the rest of our lives discovering and unpacking what it means for God to love you. Because if we already knew it, then we would love other people in the same way. But often we don't. We view people as obstacles. And this may be preaching it myself, but I get impatient with people. And it's almost 98% of the time it's when I'm waiting in a line somewhere. It has nothing to do with the people in front of me. It has everything to do with me. And so my own secret Lenten practice that I've been doing for a week now is when I find myself in those moments, I say to myself, God delights in this person too. And you say that enough, and it begins to change the way you view other people. Right? And we're Midwesterners, so we are experts at being nice, right? We know what it's like to, as we leave a gas station, to hold the door open for people as they're coming our way. And at the same time, we know what it means to get a little disgruntled when you hold the door for somebody and they don't accelerate their pace to ease the amount of time you're holding the door, right? Those are all laughs of recognition. You all have been there. And we do it because we don't want to be seen as the jerk. We do it because we don't want to be seen as a mean person. We do it out of obligation. Because out of some way in which we're raised. But if we really embraced and understood what it means that God delights in you and I the same and every single person that we see, we begin to serve one another in a different way. Not out of obligation or guilt or not wanting to be that guy. We love because we recognize that God delights in that person too. That God rejoices with that person too. So I want to challenge you. If you don't have a Lenten practice, and there's a number of them out there, how might you practice saying to yourself over and over again that God delights in this person too? Asking God to change your heart and my heart so that we really begin to recognize God's delight and joyfulness with us all. Here in just a minute, the children are going to come in and they're going to sing for us. That's my cue. I don't know who's supposed to go get them or where they are. But I promise, in a minute, there's going to be kids coming in and singing. And if they're not, well, I'm not going to do a solo. I love you enough to not put you through that. I think we're a little early. I think they expected me to talk a lot longer than I have. While they're doing that, I'm gonna pray for us that God might use us this week. God might teach us again and again what it means that God's love is for us and for others. So God, we give you thanks for all of this. I'm going to give you thanks that on your last week where you had a moment to share what's most important to you, you shared your love for all people. You shared that the most important thing we could ever do in our life is to love. And so God, while in our finite state and our simple-mindedness, we may not fully understand it, Lord, I pray that you help us unpack it. That you help us to recognize that you don't just tolerate us, but that you rejoice in us. You delight in us, and you like being with us. Lord, I pray that you would help us to do the same for others. Lord, it's in your name we pray. Amen.